Chapter 3, Virginity, Purity, and the Gray Area in Between. Y'all, did I miss the mark on this one? And I wonder if that's kind of a lot of y'all's stories too, because I find more and more, especially for women within the church who were raised in that, that becomes our story. We make this like virginity vow. We put on the promise ring. We, you know, get the diploma after a purity weekend conference. And suddenly we have this prideful banner that we can wave and, you know, proclaim our self-righteous virginity. Then temptation comes and we start to ask ourselves, okay, but how far is too far? Like, I'll be a virgin, but how far can I push the envelope? What really counts as virginity? We fall right back into this legalism, this prideful rule following of, well, I'm still a virgin, but, and we wrestle with the details and the darkness. That was so my story, because I had been talked to a lot about virginity, but no one had truly talked to me about purity, what purity really meant. I love this passage from the book on page 43. If you have your book, grab it real quick. Page 43 says, "The narrow focus of virginity is just the surface layer, under which God is inviting us into immeasurable depths of wisdom, freedom, and love. A one-dimensional focus on virginity robs us of the depth of our own soul's yearning for intimacy and its deep desire for abiding worship and worth." No, God doesn't solely call us to virginity. He calls us in all ways to purity and the power of its incredible purpose in our lives. I wish someone had said that to me when I was a teenager. I wish someone had clarified for me that God doesn't just care about our actions, He cares about the condition of our hearts. That would have shifted a lot for me. God blesses those whose hearts are pure, for they will see God. That's Matthew 5:8. When we honor God with our purity, purity in our thoughts, purity in our actions, purity in what we watch, purity in what we listen to, when we are compelled into purity, virginity becomes a byproduct. It becomes a beautiful response that's not this works-based answer to a life surrender question, but it's a byproduct of a heart that's faithfully following God. I love diving into the fact that He calls us to purity because, number one, He is a perfectly pure God. Number two, there was purity on the cross. Christ came to die to wipe the slate clean for us. And number three, He then calls us to purity because that very thing is what invites us into the kingdom work of God, that we would be pure temples to carry the Holy Spirit, to do His kingdom work and be undefiled by impure lives, impure thoughts, bondage, shame, all the things that bind us when we fall into this well of sexual sin. So purity, it has this beautiful coursing meaning through our lives, through our relationships with God. And it's so much more impure, and it's so much more important than just virginity. But I lived in the gray area in between. How far is too far? Rather than, God, how close can I draw near? So I've got some questions for the group. Number one, did you ever take that virginity vow? Did you ever wear the promise ring that like turned your finger green after an hour of wearing it? Did you get the diploma after the purity course at church that really was just kind of a driven home message of like, do this, don't do that? Talk about it. How old were you? In a culture that has a lot to say about what and how and why and when you should lose your virginity, how did your pride and that pressure collide in order to affect your decision making? Did you lose your virginity at prom because you thought you were supposed to? Are you still a virgin and struggling with that and moving through a world that kind of shames it? What does that look like for you? Last question for this chapter. Why do you think that God talks far more in His word about purity than He ever does about virginity? What do you think the difference is? Why does it matter? It's chapter 3 in the books, from the book, in the book. We're done with chapter 3. Let's move on to chapter 4.